call this meeting to order. In pursuant to Governor Baker's COVID-related orders, we are meeting via remote participation tonight, and a copy of the Grafton Public Meeting Remote Participation Guidelines is available on the town website for reference. So we'll do a roll call really quickly. Greg Maher.
Here.
Sue Robbins.
Here.
Jeremy Graves.
Here.
Colleen Roy, present. And then for town, we have Miss Anita Patel.
Here, I apologize.
No problem. Paul Knoyer.
Knoyer here.
Chris McGoldrick.
Chris McGoldrick here.
Awesome. And it looks like Mr. Matt Often joined us as well.
I am present.
Perfect. So today we're just going to start by going through the departments really quickly. And Anita, I apologize. I feel like the school might want to go last because there are quite a few things that I think people might have questions on. So we might start with planning or DPW first. So I guess we'll just start with DPW. So Mr. Knoyer, if you want to go first, I actually made a little slide with some of your requests that we can share real quick from our visit the other day. But if you want to talk about your requests or if anybody has any questions.
So we have four requests, one for the six-wheeler, which is that truck 44, one for truck 42, which you have the picture of, zero-turn mower replacement, and so some general maintenance. So one of the loaders to get us, hopefully buy us about 10 more years of use out of the machine. So truck 44, as you can see, it's a 2005 International, 54,000 miles on it. Mostly used obviously in the winter time for salting, sanding, and plowing, and then occasionally during the summer months. While the body looks somewhat fine, it's been sandblasted and painted once already. In the interior of the bed, as Colleen can attest to, was severely rotted inside. The thing I want everybody to know is if this is funded next May, it takes, so that'll be one more winter season with it. And then it takes at least a year to get the truck once we order them. So if it's funded in May, we order it in July. We won't see that truck till the following July. So it's got two more years of service that it needs to put in regardless. Truck 42, we would replace in kind. Similar situation this winter, you know, using that truck. And then if we order it next June, July, even the smaller trucks are longer lead time now. Just they get backed up from COVID and they, you know, we ordered a truck last June after the town meeting, so say July. And we won't see that truck till they said the springtime at the earliest. And that truck right now is about 94,000 miles on it. It's 10 years old, so it'll, you know, another 15, 20,000 miles on it by the time we replace it. It will be replaced with a similar body, but it will be aluminum and not the carbon steel. Again, with an aluminum lift gate to eliminate the rusting. And we also, there's a price reduction from the other one tons we've bought historically because we bought diesel motors. They're a lot more expensive than a gas motor. And for what we use the trucks for primarily, you know, hauling around loom and mulch and plowing and other maintenance. We don't need that expensive of a motor. The gas motors nowadays will last just as long. And the repairs to the diesel motors are expensive. So it's more cost benefit for us to just go with a gas motor. The zero turn is just what it says. It's a lawnmower. The DPW staff has two lawnmowers. The cemetery department also has two. So this one is the oldest one we have. It's 2,800 and whatever. So say 2,900 hours on it. It's not so much the hours in the motor because it's a diesel. The motor will last. It's the rest of the components of the machine, you know, up and over curbs and mowing islands and hitting rocks and all kinds of debris that gets flung out of people's cars. So they do take a beating. We replaced one of the hydraulic drive motors in the back, which was about $2,000 this year. So it's only just going to get more more costly to maintain it. And then if we're down to just one mower while this one's down, it's just more work and just a less efficient operation. And then the other thing we asked for was money for the loader, which I don't know if you have a picture of that, Colleen. It's behind that other truck.
I don't. I wish I did. I didn't start taking pictures until we made it further in the tour there, but I did see it and it is rotted out. I think restoring it is in order at some point for sure.
So yeah, so our goal on that would be, right now we have three machines, two of which plow, the third machine just runs around the DPW yard during the winter and during the summer as well. Used primarily for loading salt in the wintertime and just moving materials around in the summer. Can't get an inspection sticker on. So the one we'd like to rebuild is one of the ones that we use on the road all the time. So we'd like to rebuild it now, and it would get us at least another 10 years of use, probably more, and it would eventually take the place of the one that's currently loading salt, which is really rotten and can't get an inspection sticker. The one we'd like to rebuild, it's $22,000, $23,000. And the person that does our inspection stickers also told us that they would not put an inspection sticker on it next year, just because as things like your own vehicles, if you have a rotted hole through your car, you can't get a sticker without repairing it. And it's in the same situation. Those are our projects.
So does anybody have any questions about those projects at all?
What did you say? You're rebuilding what?
One of the loaders.
The loaders, the 38?
Yeah, number 38 is a John Deere. It's a 2010. It's to the point now where it needs to be done or it's won't be able to be done. So now's the time to do it before it gets any worse.
And you're hoping to get another 10 years out of that? Hope.
At least, Matt, it would get us a bunch more years on the road. And then once it's done on the road, just move it to loading salt. I mean, that's where they really take the beating because it just sits, you know, for example, we salted last year 23 times, but we only plowed 5. So it's constantly in that pile of salt. And if we can keep the decent machines out of that salt, it'll just last longer. That's our goal.
And so that will replace the current sort of yard truck when it gets too old. Got it.
Yep.
How much extra life are you expecting to get out of these vehicles now that, so presumably they'll be stored under better conditions in the new facility?
It's hard to quantify. The newer vehicles we've been buying, it's stainless bodies in the back with the fiberglass front ends, and the carbon steel we have now is already, it's already, once it starts to rust, they just keep going faster and faster. So the hope is that with the equipment we installed in the new garage, high heat pressure washes from the wash bay to really do a thorough job. And then just keep, once they're clean and dry, keeping them clean and dry. For example, it rained several times last week, and because the trucks are inside now, they're not getting wet again, which just activates the salt again. Because you can't get it all off, no matter how hard you try.
Yeah, of course.
So I did have a question about one of the other requests that isn't an equipment. It's the George Hill Road Engineering, and that is a multi-year thing. You had it marked as urgent or legal, and I was just wanting to talk about that a little bit, and if we did do the engineering part of that, how long would that be good for? And if we start it, is that something where we're setting up a domino effect where we would have to be committing to it after that?
I just put urgent or legal just because if you drive down that road, and since Sue lives on it, I'll let her elaborate further if she wants. It's in horrible shape. The residents have been after the town for years to get it done. We know it's a huge cost in a multi-year project, but no, I don't think, once we have the design in hand, which, is the first step before you can even go out to bid or even solicit bids, we need the design so we can actually get an accurate cost, opinion of probable cost to fix it. And what really needs to be done, easements, takings that need to happen to get the drainage off the road and into areas where it can be dispersed properly and not just in the trenches along the side of the road. So it's just It needs to happen. It needs to get on the radar, you know, so people are aware that it does need to happen.
Does anybody have any further DPW questions for tonight?
So this year you have a zero turn mower on for $12,000. Looking to future years, you have four more zero turn mowers at $30,000 a piece. Could you explain those?
Those are cemetery ones, Greg?
Yes.
It should only be, there's one each year, not two each year. So they have two machines. So I don't know how that, maybe I misprinted that. I don't have that form in front of me.
There is one listed for a 2009 Ferris zero turn mower in 23 and 26.
Yeah.
And then a 2016 Ferris zero turn mower in 23 and 26.
All right. So it should just be one. So two total, one in 23 and one in 26.
Okay.
And it's a cemetery. It's a separate department, and they mow the parks, the fields, the common, those areas. So those, they're a much bigger machine, as it just takes, you know, you think about mowing, you know, one of the soccer fields takes, you know, while the highway department hour-wise spends as much time, they don't cut nearly as much grass. It's going to mow a 200 square foot island. Mm-hmm. It takes time, but it's not a big job. But the cemetery ones, they're a 6 foot deck with a 7 foot deck with a 30 horsepower or 50 horsepower motor. They're just much bigger machines. Okay. But there's only one each year.
The other question was about, it says, with every new subdivision and athletic field, what does a subdivision involve in additional mowing for a DPW?
A lot of the newer ones that come in, you know, Chris is here. If he can elaborate if you wanted. We end up taking strips of land at the entrances to the new subdivisions. So for example, off Adams Road is going to be High Point Drive, and there's a huge area of grass as you come off Adams Road onto High Point Drive. And that's going to have to be mowed weekly or bi-weekly, and that's going to need to be done by the DPW.
Okay.
I just have one last question out of curiosity. Sorry, Matt. And this is just, I know how you said if you order a truck now, let's say you got approved now, it's still a year out. What if on the off chance we decided to fund the engineering instead of any of these trucks, would these trucks survive an additional year of waiting?
Yeah, we'll make with what we have. We always have. And it's just what I wrote in my brief narrative. It's if one breaks, you saw we have one spare, which doesn't have the same capabilities as other trucks. It does, you know, it's that truck is 30 something years old. It doesn't have the horsepower, it doesn't have the capacity, it can't move as much snow, the plow doesn't angle. So you, as new subdivisions again come on, we have more and more miles of road, an expectation of the public that this is what we've come to expect. And I have, you know, we'll do what we have to do. And if it takes longer, it just takes longer. But, you know, we have two great mechanics who will, you know, do their very best to keep them running.
Just one last question. So when you guys put together the list of roads to be delivered with the road stabilization, was there any consideration to funding the engineering out of that money or out of Chapter 90?
There was not. There was no discussion on it. We had discussed using the Chapter 90 money for it. Just as we get, you know, with a Main Street project coming up, we need a certain dollar figure for the easements on that.
Yep.
We got a grant to replace the bridge on Fitzpatrick Road, a small bridge. So that's going to be Chapter 90 funded. We have the culvert on Stowe Road that we have now have the design for that we need to fund replacement of that culvert as well, and that's going to be Chapter 90 fund. So there won't be much Chapter 90 money left by the time those projects are complete.
Okay. All right. So I think that's something that we want to talk about, because obviously we want to be using the most restrictive money to be paying for, you know, various elements of the capital. So this would be a potential opportunity to do that. But I get it. Thanks.
I I just wanted to know, Paul, are there state grants available for any of these projects for like the road, or do they give state grants for trucks or anything?
We did get that grant from the Volkswagen diesel
program
last year. So we got $187,000, I think. We paid, you know, which was 80% of the cost of the truck. We, you know, we just got, so that's the only grant I know of that's available for those kind of vehicles. And we were fortunate, you know, very fortunate to get that. But that truck's a great example. We ordered that truck a year and a half ago, and we got that. That truck came in September. So it just, it took a long time to get. The roads, it's, we've looked at different avenues for roads. There's a current grant right now that Carter sent us last week, and it says roads are part of it, so we can take a look at it. There's not a whole lot for a road like George Hill. Main Street, there's a lot of, obviously, we get the grant for that.
Yeah. So.
We can't hear you calling.
At all?
No, that's better.
Oh, good. All right. So I just want to thank Mr. Canoria for coming in and answering everybody's questions. And we can move on to planning if that's okay with everybody. All right. Thank you so much, Paul.
Thanks, Paul.
Thanks, Paul.
Yep, thank you.
If you would like to discuss your request.
Thank you. So the planning department submitted two capital plan requests. We have the master plan update and the complete streets. I did want to start with the master plan. That's our most urgent ask. So the master plan update, I won't lecture on exactly what a master plan is, but in broad terms, it's the it sets a roadmap for the community. It evaluates kind of where we are in a comprehensive sense, taking into account housing, economics, and all of those features, and sets the roadmap for policy, looking at, you know, when we change policy, we can draw on the master plan and the information that it provides, as well as to help us to evaluate our current regulations and make sure that they're still effective and our current policies are effective. So it's a very broad and comprehensive plan. It also dictates to plans that fall under it that are more specific, which in a way are incorporated. So looking at our housing production plan and open space and recreation plan, which were recently approved by the state, these are more specific plans that would then draw on them. Our master plan is currently very out of date. I believe it was 2001. Was the last master plan update. Typically, communities at the longest recommend updating every 10 years. So we are well out of date on a master plan. The way that I structured the master plan update, we looked at several other communities in the past 5 years that have updated their master plans and what their requests for proposals, what their kind of budgets were looking at. Typically in recent years, we see between $90,000 and $150,000 for a master plan. Master plans are large undertakings. They include a significant amount of data collection, a significant amount of analysis of that data. We look at, there's a very extensive public engagement process, which allows the public to really engage in that policy making, that policy directive for the future of the town. And so there's an extensive public engagement process that will look at all these different aspects, both specifically and larger broadly in a comprehensive context. And then obviously that is pulled together along with the data and creates that full final master plan. So with that budget, and the idea of having $100,000 as a total ask, we felt would be adequate for a competitive master plan without hitting the top mark of what we saw of 150,000. So 100,000, I think we would have a really good plan to be developed with a budget of that amount to make it more palatable and to lower the fiscal impact of that. We drew on a strategy that I stole from Harvard that splits it over three fiscal years. And this was also part of Carter Terenzini's suggestion, which I think is a really good idea. And so looking at it over the course of 3 years, we're asking for fiscal 22, a $30,000 funding, which would start that data collection and analysis. Because of the heavy lift, likely this would be contracted out to a consultant. But that starts the process. It creates the wealth of data and information that we can then use along with the public process, which would start in fiscal year 23. For that, we're looking for $50,000. And so that'll include a lot of public forums bringing in meetings with the public, with different boards and committees, with different stakeholders in town that we identify, and using that data and what we found from the data initially, we'll be able to bring in the public and have those deep conversations and develop that data further in the context around it. And then fiscal year 24, we have an ask of $20,000. And that phase will mainly be taking what we found in the public process, what we found from the data, and then finalizing that into a final published report. And so that's our first ask. And I think we can go into questions before, I think that would be better before going into the complete streets.
Chris, are there any grants available through like CMRPC or anything like that for the comprehensive plan? I totally get why we want to do that. I think that actually having one in hand helps us get grants. But I'm wondering if there are, you know, any matching grants available to be able to help fund that.
Yeah, not that I'm specifically aware of. Like you mentioned, a lot of times the master plan is a prerequisite to or helps in applying for some of the grants. Typically the grants that I've seen are more specifically geared at policy, specifically like a zoning update, which the master plan would help to facilitate. So I can look further into additional grants, but none that I'm aware of off the top of my head.
Okay, thanks.
So Chris, this is legally, this is a mandate that you have to update this master plan?
So Massachusetts is a state that does not require a master plan to be updated. Other states do. And again, it's even though it's not required, kind of standard thinking in the field is that at most 10 years, would be the shelf life of a master plan update. After that, you know, communities obviously shift quite a bit in terms of their context over the course of 10 years. And so using that data then in developing policy, you're really using stale information and a viewpoint of the perspective that is a decade or more old. And so really having that process kind of it shows a roadmap again of where we're going to go. It helps form that roadmap of where the community wants to go, not just the staff or the boards and committees. It really allows the entire community to set that roadmap. And it also allows kind of a view from where did we come in those, the 10 or 20 years from the previous master plan. So it does give that kind of progress report as well.
I know that there are some people who get the impression that our master plan has been sitting on the shelf And I just like to say that former town planners like Steve Bishop and Joe Layton, they did use the master plan. They looked at it quite frequently, and it was used more often than people thought it was. And I know when I was on economic development, I looked at the master plan for goal setting for some of the things that needed to be done. So it has not been sitting on the shelf. It has been used.
Yeah, and that's, I think, so the master plan is, when I say shelf life, I didn't mean to imply that it is not used. It's, I think the master plan is probably the most critical plan that the planning community, and I know a lot of the other boards and committees use when they try to make those decisions. And so that's why, that's exactly why I think it needs to be updated. And I'd recommend that we do move towards updating it to have that accurate and timely data rather than using old data in that decision-making process.
The town has changed so much that it really, yeah. I mean, I agree with you. And I wasn't making reference to when you use shelf life. I just wanted, there are people who think that the master plan has been sitting there and has not been used, and that's far from the truth, so.
Right.
Gotcha.
Oh, yep. Sorry.
Oh, do you want to discuss the Complete Streets?
Yeah, so Complete Streets program. So this is a state program through MassDOT, and it's a three-tier program. I have worked on this program in other communities, and so what you do is you start with a Complete Streets policy that the select board would adopt in the first tier, which is essentially indicating that they understand the goals and objectives of Complete Streets. And sorry, I should go into that a little bit. So the Complete Streets is looking at not just streets geared towards vehicles, but looking at streets that can accommodate bicycle and pedestrian infrastructure as well as a vehicle. So a more complete and comprehensive road infrastructure, and allowing multimodal, you know, bus traffic as well, things like that, and that, you know, a more complete network. Obviously, that is an expensive undertaking for any community to upgrade their roads to be more complete and to be more accommodating to other modes of traffic. And that's where this program comes in to assist in funding those upgrades. And I think has seen a lot of success throughout Massachusetts. So it is a three-tier program. The first is adopting a policy, which technically is non-binding, but it is a kind of goal setting of the community saying that, you know, they do understand the goals of Complete Streets. They subscribe to that, and they are, you know, in their decision-making processes, they will incorporate the Complete Streets ideals. The second phase is what's called a, of course, I'm going to blank on the name of it. It's a, essentially a plan where, you know, the network as a whole is looked at in terms of that Complete Streets kind of consensus, and it develops an idea of where improvements can be made, and it sets a schedule for those improvements to be completed. In other communities, this was contracted out to CMRPC, and they developed a plan. And it gives a map as well as cost estimates for upgrading any of the municipal roads. So it does not apply to state roads, but any of the municipally owned roads and infrastructure, and sets the plan for updating those to a more complete street standard. And the when that plan is developed, the cost of that is reimbursed through the Complete Streets program. The third tier of it, you become a tier three community, which allows you to be eligible for annual reimbursements of up to $300,000 in road infrastructure improvements. So this is actually taking the plan, which has pieced out all of the road infrastructure into each of the kind of $300 or $300,000 pieces, and each year you apply to complete that work and that is reimbursed. So the ask here tonight, ideally, that because it is a reimbursement program in a technical sense, the town spends no money. All of the funds are reimbursed in the end. In an ideal situation, what I found is that it is reimbursement. And so you know, going through the process, you do receive an invoice and you have to pay the invoice and then you get reimbursed. So it's a little bit of a chicken and the egg kind of a situation. And so having the $300,000 committed allows for a smoother transition and allows for that progress to continue without having to kind of wait for a reimbursement of the amount. So it just puts us in a better situation.
For FY22, that's just in years going out. I think that's for 23 and 24 you had on their question. Yeah.
Yeah, so similarly, I looked at you could move through the program more quickly, but I think looking at our objectives and especially with the master plan, I think it'll dovetail with those efforts, obviously. So I think, you know, the way I envision moving through it in a timeline way would be fiscal 22 would be the policy adoption. The fiscal year 23 would be that prioritization plan. That was the term I was looking for. The prioritization plan, which looks at, you know, that gets consulted out, but sets the project list. And then the fiscal year 24, we would start with that annual reimbursement or the actual implementation.
Okay, that sounds good. Does anybody have any questions about that?
So just to clarify, looking at FY22 is no cost adoption of non-binding policy. 23 is the 50,000 for developing the plan. And then 24 is actually starting to implement. And there is reimbursement for everything in 23 and 24.
Right. Correct. So that's where the 50,000 would allow the development of the prioritization plan. That would then get reimbursed for 24. And so that way, by adding the additional 250,000 in 24, we reach the 300,000 and we could complete up to the maximum reimbursement amount.
Have there been several towns that have done this, Chris?
Yes, I don't know all of the towns off the top of my head. If you go to mass.gov and the Complete Streets program, they do have a map which shows each community and their which tier they are in the process. So just as a background, in during my time in Shrewsbury, we went when I started, they were a tier one community, and we moved through the tier two process, achieving tier three status during my time there.
Okay, any other questions for Mr. McGoldrick? Well, thank you very much for coming in tonight and spending some time with us and answering all of our questions.
Thank you.
All right, so now we're going to move on to conservation. Ms. Leah Cameron's here to discuss 46 Adams Road.
Good evening. If you guys are familiar with the property Hennessy off of Adams Road, it's 60 Adams Road to be more specific. Conservation owns that property. It is the largest parcel the commission is in charge of. However, we don't have any accessible frontage in conservation's name for that property. So what happens right now is 46 Adams Road is just owned in general by the town of Grafton. Residents use that lot for parking. It's where the old barn remnants are. And so people park there and access the trail system down an easement with, I think it's 48 Adams is the neighbor on that side. So it was brought to the town staff's attention that the barn, or what is left of the barn, is in danger of collapsing, perhaps this winter, depending on snow load. So that was the reason for the status that I put on this project, because the barn needs to come down. However, we're looking to sort of wrap it into a project where we get 46 Adams, which would give the Conservation Commission property in the back the frontage to continue where people park and where people know to access the property. So putting 46 Adams in the commission's name, which I believe would be a corrective deed at this point, and then taking that barn down for safety reasons, and then sort of reusing that space to make the parking situation better, and to we want to improve the trailhead and shift it away from 48 Adams, because right now it's a very awkward place to access the property. A lot of people don't even know that that's how you can get to it, because they feel like they're walking in someone's backyard. So that was the project that I submitted, the most urgent piece, of course, being the barn.
So does anybody have any questions about this project? The only question Sue, go for it.
No, you go ahead. I'll wait.
The question I had was the $500 worth of other funding. What is that specific towards, some part of the project or?
Yeah, the 500 is sort of a placeholder number, depending on what the cost is, whether it's a corrective deed or whatever we would need town council to do to put 46 Adams under the care of the Conservation Commission specifically, because I wasn't totally 100% certain on what that process looks like. I put down the $500. If it's just a matter of recording fees, it would be much less.
So the question I had to ask was similar in line. Do we have to have a warrant article and take this to town meeting to transfer the deed to conservation from the town?
I believe so, yes.
So you would need a warrant article.
Yep.
Or for May town meeting.
I believe that is the process. Okay. I will double check with town council as to the intricacies of this going forward. Okay. But I believe it's just a corrective deed is what I've come across in my research.
And the barn itself, because most of it is cinder block, you're talking about the roof, it has all rotted out.
Yeah, so it was actually Paul Kenoyer is familiar with it from being out there, as well as the building inspector. So the barn roof is what's in most danger of coming down. However, throughout the walls, there are really old windows, most of which have been broken into and then boarded up, but the boards then fall down. So there's also concerns about access. And kids getting in there, and you know, God forbid something were to happen.
Thank you.
Okay, any other questions on this project at all? Amy?
So just to be clear, because you have the 55,000 under other, that 55,000 takes care of removing the building and the trailhead modifications?
So actually the trailhead modifications would be done in-house. We've done a lot of work for the conservation properties with the DPW staff. And I've talked to Paul about what it is we'd be looking to do, and he felt that we had all the equipment and manpower we would need. So that figure is actually just the demolition work. That was an estimate provided to me from the building inspector.
And that includes the demolition, and I assume that also includes taking all the material away and disposing of it?
Yep.
That seems like a pretty good deal to me, but for you.
Sue, did you have something else you wanted to say?
I was just amazed that $55,000 to demolish a building and take it away is that expensive. I didn't think it was cheap. I thought it would, you know, be a little bit less. But anyway, I don't know anything about buildings to demolish them, so I'll take your word.
I think it's because it's cinder block, Sue. That would be my guess.
I guess that's why I'm thinking it should be less, because it is cinder block.
Well,
no, maybe it's because it's heavier. I don't know.
I'm not sure myself.
I'm not an engineer, so never mind.
Okay, any other questions on this Adams Road project? All right, well, thank you for your time tonight, Ms. Cameron, and let us know if you have any other information for us, okay?
Thank you.
Thank you. And now we're on to Ms. Patel and the schools.
Hi, everyone. How are you tonight?
Good.
Good.
All right, we will start. I had emailed over the list of all of our projects. I just wanted to make sure that everyone has them. And I actually just sent an updated list over to Colleen and Amy over email. I'm not sure if you got it or not, but all I did is just make a few edits here and there.
When did you send that out? Because I don't think I've seen anything.
So it's basically the same exact list. All I did is delete some projects off of there. There was some projects on there,
right,
for some of the schools, but they were already included on the train project list. So I deleted them off of this.
Right.
So what I'll do is I'll go over our first six priority items, if that's okay. All right, so our first one, we need to replace our lawn tractor. Right now, we've had a tractor since 2003. It mows 5 of the 6 lawns for all of our schools. And right now it's costing us so much money in repairs. So I think it's time, after 17 years, we decided just to purchase a new one. It's around $18,000. Our second item on the list is we were looking to replace floor tile at the Millbury Street Elementary School. Every year we replaced tiles between 5 and 6 rooms per year. Tony, our director of buildings, he usually meets with the building principal and they go over which rooms that they're going to be doing the work for. They usually meet towards the end of the school year, so that the work can be done over the summer.
So that's just a replacement due to wear and tear?
Yes.
Got it.
And what's that cost?
That is around $48,000.
Okay, I see it here. Thanks.
You're welcome.
And if I can interrupt for just a second.
Yes, of course.
I did just send the members of the committee, I just found it, I apologize, I haven't checked my school committee email today, but I found the list and I sent it to everybody on the call.
Thank you.
And one of the things about the MSES tile situation I just wanted to point out is that those are the tiles that they weren't properly installed to begin with. Mm-hmm. And that's why we're having this issue. People often bring that up because that building's not that old, but the wrong adhesive was used during the installation. And so it's an ongoing issue that's been happening. I want to say this is the 5th year, it might be the 4th. So it's a known problem.
So when are we going to be done with all of the tile?
I would have to speak with Tony about. I'm not sure how many rooms he has left to do.
Okay. I think just so that we can do our 5-year plan, if you guys are planning on doing, you know, 6-7 rooms a year, it'd be good to know when we're done.
That's fine. Next on our list is to repave the playground at South Grafton Elementary School. The blacktop surface has large cracks in it that needs to be repaved. But I should mention that Dr. Cummings had applied for an ADA grant, and he applied for around $250,000. And part of that ADA grant was to fix the South Grafton Elementary School playground, which included the ADA handicap accessibility as well. We had applied for that in the middle of October. We're still waiting to hear. There's around $2 million to be given out. We're not exactly sure how much of that $2 million we'll be getting. There were other communities that also applied as well. So we're hopeful that we'll get some of the money to help with this project as well. Next is handicap parking at the Millbury Street Elementary School, which is for $52,000. In order to do that project, we're gonna have to move the light pole. So it's basically right in front of the front entrance. So we would have to move the light pole, we would have to remove the grass and then build a retaining wall in order for the parking spots to go right in front of the building. And then our fridge replacement at South Grafton Elementary School, which is around $65,000. We have the original fridge there from 1975. It's a little dated. We do have to make repairs here and there, but we feel it's time to replace it now.
At some point, you're not even going to find replacement parts.
Well, exactly. Exactly.
That fridge is almost as old as I am.
And then finally, for our top six is we need to do some plumbing and HVAC repairs throughout the district. And these HVAC repairs are not included on the train project. And they're anywhere, they're from gate valves, replacing thermometers in our heating system, replacing piping. So those three items are not included on the train project list that we had talked about before.
So you mentioned the ADA grant for the South Grafton. Would that also come in with the handicap parking at Millbury Street if you were to get that grant or no?
No, it would not. It would not.
Does anybody have any questions about the top six priorities from the school? And the total for that is $385,000 to do all six of those.
How much is that? What did you say? 285?
385,000.
Okay. Thanks.
You're welcome. So no questions for Ms. Patel?
So are these the things that you would like to see in this year, and things beyond that are things you're looking at for future years, or are there other ones that you would like to see in this fiscal year?
Those ones that I spoke about are the ones that we would like to see in this fiscal year.
Okay.
How do the bleacher replacements factor in as far as safety, and why weren't those given higher priority?
So honestly, we were trying to, so the our insurance company are the ones that were recommending that we replace the bleachers. So basically they want us to replace the bleachers with mechanical assisted opening and closing, because they think that because you manually have to open them and close them, and they think that someone's going to hurt their back doing so.
Okay. Any other questions for Ms. Patel? Amy?
I'm not sure if you know this or not, but is there any possibility of a different funding source for something like the field house? Which is definitely something that would be lovely to have. It would be great to have more bathrooms and more storage for athletic equipment.
So I was actually speaking with our buildings manager today about about CPA money. And I wasn't sure if we would, you know, I was gonna reach out to John Stevens to see if that would be a possibility for us to be able to get money from CPA in order to do that.
That's a good idea.
Yeah.
Can't hurt to try. Yeah. It's just one of those things that I can see that being pushed down in favor of other, I don't want to say more pressing, but things like the bleachers that have to do with safety.
Mm-hmm.
I could see the field house being looked at as a nice to have, and it is a nice to have, right? I mean, we're still having football games, although not right this minute, without the field house. But there are definitely some other concerns on the list that I think would probably end up taking precedence. The handicap ramp for SGES, is that something that we're not in compliance with at this time, or I think it's number 16 on the list?
That is something that I would have to talk to Tony about.
Okay.
And I can get back to you on that. Sorry.
That's okay. Don't apologize. It's fine. It just stuck out to me.
Okay, so if there are no other questions for Ms. Patel, thank you for going last tonight. I really thought there would be a lot of questions, so I apologize for that. And thank you for coming in and spending the evening with us.
Thank you for having us. Thank you. Okay, bye.
Thanks, Amira.
Okay.
I think there probably would have been a lot more questions if we'd gone through the whole list as opposed to just the ones for this year.
That's fair.
Targeting for this year.
All right. So as far as reviewing the capital package, does everybody feel like all of their questions has been satisfied and could go on scoring from this? Or how do you guys want to proceed?
Well, do we want to worry about how much money we have, or do we want to just do the scoring?
I think we should just score, and then, you know, it'll tap out where it taps out. The way that Excel sheet is designed is that it doesn't really matter what the number is. Once we get our number, we plug it in and we'll know what we can fund based off what we prioritized. And by we fund, we mean what we recommend, and, you know, the TA can do whatever they want. But,
you know. Yeah, I think differently.
Okay.
I, you know, to me, I just rather know how much money we can spend, because that prioritizes my thinking of what, you know, it probably shouldn't, but it does. We only have so much money every year, so.
Yep, and I feel like this is a good year for us. I feel like we're gonna have a little more than we're used to seeing, and we probably won't see another big year like this between you know, free cash, that super park money, and the override money. We might be able to do it, squeak in a little more than we're used to squeaking in, and then can't guarantee that going years out. So, the other thing I'm concerned about is time. We're running out of time. You know, December 1st is going to be here really quick. We have Thanksgiving next week. I was just looking at the calendar, trying to figure out days to meet again. I feel like we really need to meet a minimum of two more times. One time after we've all scored it and review that and kind of see what it looks like. And then one more time to tweak whatever final product we hand in. That being said, it leaves us with meeting possibly this Friday. Next week, the only time available would be either Wednesday or Friday, both not ideal days for most people. And then after that would be Monday, November 30th. So, right. I don't know how everybody feels about that and how you want to proceed going forward with that. But I will say I'm also having difficulty getting on the score sheet to begin with. I was talking with both Amy and Greg today. I don't think I have the right invite anymore, or I'm not having access to it. So the only worksheet I can see is the original one Greg did. I don't see the one that includes all the schools in it. So I think we need to make sure everybody can see what we need to see so we can go in and start scoring when we decide to start doing that.
I looked at that tonight. Colleen was on there with her personal email rather than her town email. So they probably just need to update the invitation there.
Got it. So we just want to invite your personal account to share.
Yeah, I can't find that. That was from like years ago when Peter sent it to me, and I used to be able to find it. And for some reason, I don't know if I accidentally deleted that invite, but I can't access it again. And
Got it.
Yeah, I don't think I have the invite either because I assumed that once it was done, because I know Matt has one and Greg has one.
Let me see if I can just do it right now.
Sorry, I'm working on the one in the FY22 directory under the CIPC share.
Cool.
So that's the official one now.
Do you know which of my many addresses are in there? I have three.
Let me find out.
Let's see.
Gmail and Mars.
Okay, so not my school. That's fine. So what I would expect to happen is that we would all get an email with the link in the email once the sheet is done and ready to be scored, which is why I haven't ventured in there because it wasn't done and I didn't want to mess anything up. So I stayed away.
So did I.
So all right. We probably Fine. All need to get the link again.
Yeah. So can you try to see if it works now, Colleen?
I don't think she heard you, Matt.
Oh, no, I did. Oh. But I look goofy now because I'm on a different screen. I don't see you guys, but you see me looking at you. All right. Nope. I'm in my town email. Did you send it to my other email?
I'm trying to. It's asking me. It's saying that you're in another org. And
a what?
It's Which one letting... do you want, Colleen? Your personal or your town?
The town would be easier, but let me check. I can check my personal on my phone real quick. Oh, there it is. Oh, wow, Matt, I just got a lot from you.
Matt is a lot.
Okay.
So Greg is going to send out the link with everything listed, correct?
I think you.
And that's how we'll know that he's done.
Did I not ask that correctly?
So your Verizon email, it's shared with that. But we will send out when it is ready to be used, which should be very soon. I just need right now it's not grouped so that the 2022 ones are together. So I just want to regroup it so all the 2022 items are up front.
Okay.
And then the other later years are later on. So
cool. Colleen, you should have it in your town account now.
So good. I'm getting to this tonight, but I mean, if you send it out tonight, I can look at it tomorrow.
Okay. I really appreciate you guys all sending that. Thank you. So Greg, you're going to be trying to collaborate so we only see or all of the ones we need to score immediately will be up front. When? How much time do you think you need to do that?
That'll be done tonight.
Tonight? Okay. Yeah. So how does everybody feel about meeting on Friday? Do you want to, because next week seems like pretty much not going to happen because I'm assuming a lot of us don't want to meet Thanksgiving Eve. And I'm imagining a lot of us don't want to meet on Black Friday. Is that a fair assumption to make?
I have no problem with Friday. But...
I can meet Friday. I really don't have a problem with Black Friday either. So
I love meeting all the time, but I don't want to put that on everybody else. So
I guess the question is, if Greg finishes tonight and we have Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and the day Friday, for those of us who don't work, is that enough time for everybody on here to do the ranking so that when we meet Friday at 7, it's a productive meeting. Because if not, then it doesn't, we shouldn't rush it.
Right.
You know, we have three folks that have full-time jobs. And I don't want to speak for them because I'm not one of them. But if you guys think you can do it in 3 days, then we could do it Friday, have one more meeting on the 30th, and that's it.
I'd like to give ourselves some time if possible. I can make Friday and I'll do the scoring. It may not be perfect, but I think it's more important for us to sort of get something that's done that we can all look at together to give ourselves a little bit more runway given, you know, the short time that we have to turn this around. So
now is Carter expecting us, definitely for the 22, is he expecting us to finish out the 5 years too by December 1st?
No, I tried to give him a realistic expectation that we won't have that by the 1st.
Okay.
He still wants it as soon as possible, but I told him, if you want something by the 1st, you're going to get FY22, and then we'll hit the road running on the 5-year plan right after that. So
good.
But and then I forwarded that email with his response as to how much free cash we're going to get. It seemed a little, I wanted more clarity on that for me personally, and I haven't gotten that yet. So I'll try to have that for Friday too, if possible, so that we could have a number. I mean, it would be nice to have a number, but if we can keep working with that one for now, I would say.
Yeah, I read the email. It was a little, I read it. I'll leave my comments. I won't judge. I will leave my comments to myself. But
so, Jeremy and Greg, how do you feel about being able to have a first pass at the rankings done by Friday?
By my count, we have 20 projects to rank, which isn't huge. No. I think we can do that.
Cool.
I'd agree.
I'm looking at the complete streets map. It looks like it's probably a third of the towns in Massachusetts actually have approved projects in FY21.
Can you share that link, Matt? Or is that something that was in the proposal that I missed?
I just went to mass.gov and complete streets. And then there's, it's called funding program participation is the, brings you to the map. So Grafton is listed as being registered, but there's probably over half the towns in Massachusetts have gotten to that stage two where they've gotten approved policies, and a third probably have gotten to approved projects and are actually getting funded. So.
I mean, we haven't even written a policy.
I know. I'm pretty keen to get it going, though, because we're leaving a lot of money on the table.
Yeah, that's the number one complaint that I hear after trash bags.
Yep.
Is that we don't really have a plan. Everybody wants sidewalks. Nobody knows how to pay for it. I mean, we all want sidewalks everywhere, right? But you can't just do it willy-nilly.
Absolutely.
But this is really cool. I like this a lot.
Oh, did we get an update from the library with the project split up?
That's something we need.
Good point.
I have not seen that. But, I mean, we did talk to her about splitting them. So, I mean, I don't know if we just want to split them on our own.
Can we? Do we have the dollar amounts for the individual pieces? I don't think we do.
Yes, there are four quotes in with the proposal.
So yeah, if you could do that, then I think we're fine. I just saw the form said, you know, lump sum of money.
Yeah, that's all I saw too.
Okay.
Yeah, the form did, but then there were supporting materials that listed each of the pieces.
I really did not read.
But we did ask her to do them individually, though.
I'll email Beth again and just touch base and see if she has that too, and then I'll if she does, I'll send it out to you guys immediately, and if not, it'll be something we can discuss on Friday too.
So when we deliver to Carter, are we including the forms and the supporting materials like as a package with our rankings?
I would say so, yeah. I think he's going to need as much information too, because again, all we're doing is giving a recommendation, but here's everything behind it and you can do with that what you will.
Okay.
So you've got all the master things that were sent out from the departments, because mine are all written on.
Well, yeah.
All right.
Well, I figured our clerk would just make one big PDF with everything.
I would think so.
Leave Greg alone.
What? He's a good clerk. He does a good job.
He's a phenomenal clerk.
And he's faster than me, so that's good.
Log off a meeting and I have the notes, the minutes in my account already. I'm like, oh, okay, here we go.
Were there any other comments from the board concerning the fire department?
When we talked about having people in, fire was not mentioned. So I did not reach out to fire. Recreation was not mentioned either. So I did not reach out to them. If you guys want to talk to anybody else, I can reach out to them. But I reached out to the departments that were discussed that people wanted to have further discussions with.
Well, that's not what I was really asking. I just wanted to know if there were comments from this committee about these other two projects.
Sorry, Sue.
I don't think we need them in. I just wanted to know if there was any comments or anything that people were concerned about. Fire always has something on Capitol.
Yep, they have a good equipment replacement program.
Yep.
What happens if train doesn't go forward for the schools?
Those items go back on the list and continue to be kicked down the road, I guess.
I'm just wondering if there's anything that, if it doesn't get funded, that would, I don't know.
Honestly, if that doesn't get funded, I feel like we're looking at a debt exclusion for the middle school at a bare minimum, because that's $1.2 million right there to just replace the HVAC. That's probably the most pressing thing. We already tried to get the windows, as you know, for street school. We'd probably have to try again. There really isn't a plan. I mean, the plan was, Dan Gale, go look and see if we can find some way to pay for all of this. You know, is there like a state program, like a mass saves or something like that? And he came back with the train thing. So that's kind of the plan. We have to, you know, and that's kind of outside of CIPC, I think. So that's going to be, you know, the schools trying to get that funded.
Got it.
Like Anita said tonight, she took everything off the list that was on train.
Yeah, there were a couple of duplicates that were not supposed to be there.
Yeah.
Because the plan was it was supposed to help us kind of run two lists at the same time, right? We have the capital list and then we have the HVAC stuff as a separate list. And one of the big questions that we still are working on answering is, what didn't get funded by the Honeywell project that was supposed to be? Because some of that stuff is on the train list. So I personally don't know. I have the list that David sent me. David Robbins had the list of what was supposed to be funded by that project. And all those building controls and things and caulking, that's all on the list. And that was 2016. But it sounds like it didn't happen.
Well, which the is building controls had to have happened.
The what?
The building controls had to have happened in order to get some of that stuff they have in there now, especially for the high school and for the municipal center. But there weren't any savings from the municipal center, but that's where most of the money went.
Yeah.
So I don't know. I would think train, I got the impression when I asked him about that, trains, there weren't that many things that they were, except for the North Street Grafton School. I don't know what I know there were univents that were done by Honeywell, but I don't know what all that was done. I don't remember. There's the list is there, but I don't remember what was.
Right. And that's the stuff. There's definitely things on that list that did not get done, but we don't know what they are. We're still trying to figure that out. But I think it's going to be outside of CIPC anyway. I think it's going to be.
Well, it is. And I think that was there some kind of a timetable with train that the school department had to look at?
So what's happening now is their train is going back and they're going to go look at North Street again. Because I think North Street was the one that there was not an HVAC.
Yeah, there was no air conditioning, right?
So they're going back, they're going to look at it again, and they're going to come back with more information in January. But I think we figured out that this is not going to get funded in time to happen summer 21, that we'd be looking to get it funded so that it could start summer 22, which I think is why that 50,000 is in here for those plumbing and HVAC, kind of some fixes to get us through
the immediate stuff. Yeah.
And okay. We just got to cross our fingers and hope that the middle school system doesn't fall apart for another year, because that's the one that we keep having to pay ridiculous amounts of money for parts when things break. You know, we don't want kids having to go to school in coats because there's no heat.
I had the school department, I mean, Jay and the school committee haven't set up a meeting with the Board of Selectmen to go over this.
Not yet, no. We're waiting for the final estimate from Train.
Okay, because they're the ones who are going to be making the decision.
Okay.
So.
Yep. Well, we'll see what Train comes back with. But I'll make sure that Laura's aware. I think she probably knows what the next step is. But I think it was nice that we discussed it here first. So we had kind of a better idea of what the plan. Because if we get this, that's huge. If you go back and look at the original list from last year's budget, that takes a lot out of that, which is good because we have so many other things. You know, $7 million worth of other things that need to happen. And that's just on the schools.
And Anita and Jay really have to come out with a real accurate budget information, because I mean, there's a lot of questions yet with all of that financing, so.
Yeah, I'm sure there will be. I mean, it was very, I thought the presentation was good. I think there's a lot of information that Train could give us that could help us kind of fill in the gaps for people. But I think it's at least worth exploring and worth pushing forward on, because it sure beats the alternative.
Well, it has to be pushed on, because earlier the better. Otherwise, yes. You're not going to get anything for the next.
Yeah, if we'd had that information in the spring. We just missed that window by a few months to get it for next summer, but then again, the budget, you know, for fiscal year 21 may not, or fiscal year 22 may not be able to handle it. I don't know.
We'll yeah, there's see. A lot of ifs about that too.
Yeah.
Fiscal 22 and
yeah,
what the whole town budget's going to look like.
Yeah, are we still going to need to be buying PPE? Who knows?
So I compared the list that Anita sent out with the list I already had, and the only things that were removed were the school roofs.
Yes. So I think they're retooling the plan, Greg, because I think so many people asked about the roofs. I think they're retooling that whole thing so that it includes the roofs. So when it comes back, I think it's going to be... It's going to look very different, I think.
So I've split the library up into four elements. The whole pickup kiosk, which is the thing that they would like to add that isn't part of the previously approved project. And then there's the RFID gates, the automated material handling, and the self-checkout. which are the things that they said were already a part of the approved project. They would just let, they were investigating pulling them out into capital, but they also said that these things need to be done this fiscal year. So I'm not sure if it even makes sense to score those, but I'm leaving them in there and we can discuss that later.
Well, do we want to talk about that?
I do, because I'm not scoring those. Those are in the project. And when she said, I'm being very blunt, I know, when she said that it's going to reduce the tax rate, it's going to reduce it by what, a couple cents? I mean, it's not even, what is the total for those projects, those three things? What did those add up to, Greg?
$215,000 approximately.
And then the kiosk was what, the outside?
41,258.
Okay, so I mean, $200,000 out of a $16 million project is not going to be any money savings for a tax, for the taxes for people.
I didn't understand how we could use money from next year's budget to pay for work being done right now. That building's going to open in June of 21.
And why, and I, my problem is that anything that's built into that project, when they do the checklist, if it isn't done correctly, and if the town puts it in, we're responsible for it, which means there's added cost. So anything that goes in that project needs to stay in that project and be done in that project. That money needs to be, that needs to stay with the project money. I don't know why she's pulling it out.
Yeah, I don't, I mean, I think the lockers are legit because it's not part of the project and can be put in after the building opens.
Yeah, but there's not a hurry for that.
Right. That's what I'm saying. Like, it's the one piece of all of that that I think we realistically should include. But the rest of it, I feel like it, I don't know. To me, it's paid for.
It is.
And I don't want to take all that money out of what we have or something that's already paid for. I don't know how everybody else feels about it.
Well, I think given our charter, we need to at least include them on the plan, even if it says we don't think that these should be included.
But there's money available for them. The point for the capital planning committee is that we're using free cash and everything else, and they already have money. So why would we look at projects that are already funded?
So maybe, well, we put that under other funding.
Funding.
Existing.
All right. Gotcha.
Yeah, I'd agree with that.
Well said, Matt. You've done this before. I'm like, this is hard.
It's all right. We'll get through it. It's our first run through. Fortunately, we do have a little bit more money this year, so we'll be able to fund a little bit more than we have historically, and that's a good thing.
A million what? What was it? A million what? Million two?
Oh, Colleen, I'm getting you a mug that says I'm on mute, even though you're not on mute. I know you're not, but it's still
funny. I think her mic just isn't sensitive enough, so it's not picking up when she's kind of leaned back a little bit.
Now she's back. I got you now.
Okay. Yes, I will work on that. I'm sorry. This is the best I can do.
Fine.
That's fine. He went through this big rigmarole. I wish he would have just given you a number. But he went through this big rigmarole to get us down to something, but
that's on my to-do list. I'm gonna try to get him pinned to a real number for free cash, because we know what's in the municipal capital stabilization account. We know what we have for the override, so those are solid numbers that we do know. So even if we have zero for free cash, we know those two numbers. I'm hoping we don't have zero for free cash, and I can try to pin him down a little bit more, but we'll see. As far as emailing the library, I had that on there as far as trying to find out about submission forms. I think we just kind of handled that ourselves, but I do want some more clarity from her as well on that. So I will shoot her an email and then we can maybe discuss it on Friday. if I get her response sooner, I'll forward it to you guys for your scoring process. So that we'll have a substantive conversation on that on Friday as well.
So with those already paid for and the three existing leases, the total request for this year is 2.7 million.
What were the three top numbers? What's that number calculated to?
The leases?
Yeah.
214,000.
There were three things that are right off the top of the capital planning.
Yeah.
The only amounts of 214?
Yep. One is 10,800. One is just under 100,000. And the other is just over 103,000.
Okay. Those are the second or third year of the lease.
Yeah. This is the last year for the 10,800. The other two have 3 and 4 years left, respectively.
Okay. Thank you.
And the 2.7 includes those?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Does anybody else have anything they want to discuss about the capital package?
I have a question. So I only see things when they come in through the email, but I assume there's a place where the package lives that I should be able to see what's been submitted. Is that an accurate statement?
Yeah, like with the planning department put together for us?
Yeah, I see are what people attach emails to, or I can get to the spreadsheet, but I feel like there's a repository I'm missing.
No, everything's been emailed.
Everything's been emailed. Okay.
I'll send it to you again.
Yeah.
I mean, so we can put it all there.
Yeah, we could. There's one that has everything but the schools.
Do you know who that came from?
Colleen. November 4th, I think.
She sent out all the packet information from the department.
Again, just losing it in the flood. Cool.
Maybe not.
I'll save it up there. I have it all.
Yeah, you put them in the FY 2022 folder.
Yep.
And we'll have it all together. All
right. Perfect.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
And just to remind you, Jeremy, the school stuff, you need both the spreadsheet that Anita sent and the last year's budget. Sorry.
Yep.
And the separate form with the mower. That was sent separately too.
Right.
But hopefully that'll all be in the folder for you.
Yep.
I don't think I've ever seen you without a hat.
No, I normally don't wear a hat. I wore a hat last week because my hair was even worse.
I think it's of Andy.
Hey, it's just this is my end of the day look.
Oh, you know, maybe I am thinking of Andy.
Thinking of Andy.
That's what it is. I'm sorry.
Wrong person, Jeremy. Andy's always got a cap on.
I make him Andy cap.
Greg. Getting late.
Right. Take him.
Can we meet? I will meet whenever you guys can. Time you can meet on Friday, but can we meet like 6 instead of 7? Or
does that work for everybody? 6 instead of 7?
Let's check our.
Yes.
Caitlin.
Wait.
Do they have a Mai Tai off screen?
Crap.
it's our Wong's night, but we do takeout anyways. So.
Yeah, I don't.
I mean, if you guys can't do it, fine. I just.
You'd get one of us at 6.
That's
not both.
I mean, I just assume all of you, but.
Nope. Okay. KD Stan's class is 6 to 6:30, and Ainsley has something else.
Well, then let's do 7. That's fine. I just thought if you could.
Well, we could cap it at 8 o'clock too. We could just say, you know what? We're done at 8.
We got an hour. Maybe we're.
So quick. We're just putting all the scores together and talking about it and tweaking it. And hopefully we have dollar amount. Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
And I'll probably screw mine up first time. So.
Oh, I think we all are.
Pretty much guaranteed.
What's a truck? I know Colleen knows trucks. That's the joke.
Aren't those trucks disgusting? God, those trucks are disgusting.
What do you mean? That they're dirty or?
No, rusty.
Oh, well, yeah, they're old. They've been out in the elements.
I like the visual. Next year, I want to get more of those. I'll go out and stake out places because I think that helps the conversation when you actually see the lawnmower or you actually see the rusted out piece of equipment or that the barn collapsing. I wish I had had a photo of that. I'll do better next year.
Well, I think Matt had a good question slash point when he brought up the fact that the barn is going to extend the life of, you know, both new purchases and the existing vehicles slash, I don't know what you call them, tools. I don't.
Yeah, they sold us hard on that when they were promoting the building, right? Yeah. all this extra time we're going to get with all this equipment. So,
well, and the
see it now.
The speed with which they'll be able to get the trucks on the roads to plow and salt. I expect. I think
with the new wash bay they have is a lot more efficient. It can get under the trucks while hoses and stuff, while they were doing it before.
It was indoor really wash bay too.
So nice. I don't think the guys, they may have already, but I think they're really going to appreciate their new garage with their, you know, lifts and their putting the plows on in a few minutes, not having, you know, they can get the trucks out fast and.
And not having to play Jenga, parking things in it.
Yep.
You remember that video too, huh, Jeremy?
Yeah.
That's what made the most impact on me.
It was nice to go into the garage and be able to put your arms way out and not touch the trucks. Before, you had to walk sideways between those. They couldn't even open the doors. So it's nice to see that.
So they're open now, huh?
Yeah. There are most of the, there's a few things that aren't totally in yet. You know, they've got a lot of tools and stuff. But when I was there a couple of weeks ago, almost everything was in the building already. So
I kind of expected there would be like, I don't know, an announcement, not a ribbon cutting, because that seems kind of weird. But
you can't. There's a grand opening, but it'll be in the spring.
Oh, okay.
Upon the COVID thing. So that's what we're hoping is going to happen. So. There'll be time, so, and you can't have anything now, so.
Well, just a Facebook announcement or something. I don't know. Let people know. Hey.
The chair.
Up to what chair?
The DPW Building Committee chair.
You're not the chair?
No.
Who's the chair?
John Bouchard.
Oh.
So, no. But there will be a grand opening, so that'll be nice. They've got a nice kitchen. The locker rooms are, Kevin picked out the colors, so you walk in the men's locker rooms. Did you see the men's locker rooms?
I did not, no. I was there to see trucks, to be honest.
I'll eat those trucks.
Main focus, bring me to the garage, let's go.
The lifts are pretty cool. I was impressed with the lifts, I'll tell you. Those things are huge, but then they need it for trucks. So, but yeah, there's orange lockers. It's real bright when you walk in.
Orange?
Yeah. I think the ladies are, not sure what the color of the ladies were. I just thank Kevin to not make them pink. You know, usually it's pink for women and that.
Grafton green would be nice. Go Gators.
Okay, let's adjourn on that note.
I move to adjourn.
Second.
All right. Viral call, Greg.
Wait.
Here. What?
What?
We have minutes?
No.
Okay.
Amy.
Aye.
Greg. Or Jeremy.
Aye.
Matt.
Aye.
Colleen, aye. Good night.